Hi everyone, welcome to our second workshop out of a series of eight free sessions dedicated to women's issues. My name is Laura Brass. I am a link instructor with VCC. I am also a PhD student in language and literacies in education at UBC. Today's moderator, Irina, is a fellow graduate student from UBC who will help us run things smoothly. We also have here today with us Dr. Jennifer Jensen, my PhD supervisor. She's a professor of digital languages, literacies, and cultures in the Faculty of Education at UBC. She's also the director of Edith Landau Virtual Learning Center, the one who actually made possible this project, this collaboration between UBC and VCC, for which I am very grateful. Prior to coming to UBC in 2019, Dr. Jensen was director of the Institute for Research on Digital Learning at York University in Toronto. I'm also really excited to welcome today's guest speaker, Dr. Elaine Morton, a high school educator whose studies focus on how mental health and emotions affect women. In her PhD dissertation, Emotionally Ever After, I love that title, Dr. Morton explored the impact of gendered emotions on behavior across classic fairy tales and modern cinematic retellings. And so I will pass it back to Dr. Morton to tell you a bit more about herself and talk about today's topic, fairy tales and feminism. Dr. Morton?
Much and thank you so much to everyone, including Dr. Jensen and Laura, for having me here to speak to you today. So I'm going to talk a little bit about fairy tales and feminism. What does it all mean? I don't know. Even if I give you a definition, as I will, of course, everything is always changing. So that's one thing I think that's really important to think about when we talk about what feminism is, always changing. So a very brief overview of what I'm going to chat with you about. First of all, what are fairy tales? Then a little bit about me, and perhaps we can find out a little bit about you, and then chat about what feminism is. I have one example I want to share of a Canadian, so to speak, fairy tale, and then I want to chat about how fairy tales are changing. So first of all, what are they? Well, they go by many names, that's for sure. You might have heard them called folk tales or traditional stories. They could also be referred to as moral stories. There are lots of different names for them. Basically, it's anything that has been passed down from one generation to the next that has typically a moral to the story, even if some of the older morals are a little bit more basic about things like finding a partner and enjoying housework, because who doesn't enjoy that, right? It's changing, luckily, as I said. But most fairy tales don't have an official original version because they've been passed down through so many generations. And so you're really just looking at oral storytelling, so people speaking from one generation to the next. I think it's also really important to talk about the idea that many of these fairy tales have their root not just in Western literature, but of course in all cultures. So for example, Cinderella has over 500 different versions that have been recorded, many of which are in other languages and in other cultures. So even though Disney has sort of made all of the fairy tales look like they're Western, they all pretty much have different versions throughout the world. So I looked at Cinderella as part of my dissertation, as well as The Little Mermaid. The Little Mermaid is a little different in that it really has a source material because Hans Christian Andersen was the original author of that story before Disney came in and gave it the Disney treatment. So it might look quite different from what Hans Christian Andersen imagined when he was first writing it, but it is one of the very few that have that sort of origin story. So to tell you a little bit about me, in addition to what Laura lovely said, thank you. I began studying film and literature really when I was in high school. I always loved watching movies and reading. And so all of my studies in university So 20 years, 20 years of post-secondary education in film and literature. So I've got a lot to say. So hopefully we'll get through some of it anyway. And as Laura mentioned, my studies focused on how gender stereotypes can hurt and or give power to female fairy tale characters. I also spend a lot of time analyzing the role played by mental health, especially in stories that are directed toward young people. I teach high school, and so I teach grade 9 to 12 on a regular basis, and especially even before the pandemic, mental health, of course, has been in a bit of a decline, I think, because young people are, of course, dealing with a lot of things in the world. So I look to see what are the movies that they take in on a regular basis saying to them, and what effect is it having on them? Now, I would love to hear a little bit about you, if you don't mind sharing. I would love to know what fairy tales, if any, that you remember reading or hearing as a child. And it doesn't have to be something from Disney. In fact, I would love to hear about any kind of oral traditions or any folk tales that you might have thought were sort of the best things that you encountered as a child, if you're able to share. Maybe Marjorie, if you could start us off. If you feel comfortable.
Okay, why not? You know that when I was a child, always many times I watched the Cinderella, and it was in, you know, that it was in Persian, and then, yeah. In Persian, they censor, you know, that they censor in my country, they censored, do you know censor? I don't know, do you understand it? They censored, and then they changed the story. And then when I a little bit bigger, and I, you know, that when the, you know, that when I can connect to the internet, on okay. That time, really, for example, when I was child, I watched another version. It's another story for me. But when after we can reach out to the internet, and that time I really I understand. I watched the original it. And then always I like Cinderella, yeah. And it's, you know, that for every us, I think it's a big dream that we have a good partner, we had a good relationship. But in a real world, just it's for us that it's a dream, it's a desire. For men, they don't care, just only for a short time. After a short time, they forget everything and they want to change everything. Yeah, for yeah. us, it's not like that.
Absolutely. And that's actually one of the main reasons why I chose to focus on Cinderella for my dissertation, because yeah. it's really... To me, I think sort of the most popular idea, that idea of going from rags to riches. So you've gone from being very poor and working very hard to this very lavish, very beautiful, expensive life. And it's
yeah, to dream and all about. The time I thought that real love just is for rich people and beautiful people. It's not for me.
Yeah, it's yeah. nice to have a fun dream of it, right?
Yeah.
Thank you. Joanna, would you mind sharing?
Yes. Last time I talked about some fairy tale of Chinese is Mulan. Remember, Laura? Mm. Yeah. So it's not only a fairy tale, but also a poem in Chinese. Mm. And also Disney put the
that's right.
Story, yes, into the film. Yeah, Mulan. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank
that's
you.
It.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you, Miranda.
Think of one love story. Probably mm. every Chinese knows. It's about like a cowherd. He as a human man living on the earth. And one day he met a weaver lady from the heaven, this kind of a very different world. And they loved each other and they had two children. But just in a while, the lady's mom from the heaven came down and to caught her to the heaven. So they were separated since then. The young man and his two children, they were really missing the lady. So he brought their two children and tried to fly to the heaven and to meet with his wife. But the mom didn't allow them to meet together because the girl disobeyed the rule of the heaven. So still they were separated, but she was moved by their love and allowed them to meet only once a year. That's on like the 7th of July. It's still like Chinese Valentine's Day now. It's a lunar July 7th. So every year at that time, they have chance to meet with each other.
Oh, that's so beautiful. Thank you. Well, and the one thing we're hearing about all of these, of course, is that women are experiencing things and, you know, they're all different stories, but of course, they're all about women overcoming obstacles to hopefully have a happily ever after. So I think that's beautiful. Thank you. Does anyone else want to share before we go on?
Could go ahead and very quickly.
I would love that. Thank you.
I was thinking of Disney fairy tales growing up. I think it was Snow White. I wasn't impressed at the love story per se, but how colorful it was. Yeah. And again, this is what was broadcast at that time back in the day. I do want to mention a fairy tale from my culture, Romanian, and it's not about women so much. It's called The Young Son and His Golden Apples in free translation. And it's about the father and his three sons. So there you go. In that fairy tale, we have no women whatsoever. And now looking at fairy tales and, you know, how we look at women, I find it quite interesting. I would like to revisit it and reread it. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to share. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, we'll keep going. And of course, you're welcome to share if you feel more comfortable a little bit later on. Okay, so also the question of what is feminism? I had mentioned a little bit earlier that even if we have a definition, it's really very much a changing thing. And quite simply, it just is the belief that men and women should receive equal treatment. I talk to my high school students all the time by asking them, okay, who thinks they're a feminist? And of course, a few female students will raise their hands. Most of the male students sort of looking around at each other like, I don't think so. And then when I say, you know, the reality is that it's actually just about wanting women and men to receive equal treatment, I think they start to change their mind a little bit. So part of it is remembering too that, of course, there are many people with extreme views that maybe don't feel like men and women should be equal so much as maybe women should get more power. That's not really what the heart of feminism is about. And so it's easy to have that get a little off track, but the reality is that it's really about equality. In academic studies, we look at the role played by women, including trans women, so those who have transitioned from being male at birth to female, in all sorts of stories. So could be movies, could be TV shows. I did an academic presentation recently actually on female characters in video games, music, basically anything where women are finding a place, which hopefully at this point is everywhere, but we're still a work in progress. But basically we're looking at the way that female characters interact not only with each other, but with male characters, and what kind of power dynamics exist. One of the very first fairy tales that I took in, that I call a Canadian fairy tale today, but I'm not sure it's an official Canadian fairy tale so much as my interpretation of it. But it's this book called The Paper Bag Princess. And it was written by a man named Robert Munch, who is a very famous children's author from Ontario, so where I'm from. And I think this book had a little bit of an effect on me. I'm going to show you what the small version looks like. So they also print a lot of his books in these tiny ones. So here's sort of like a board book for kids. But yeah, the tiny ones were what I read when I grew up. So they were just little tiny books with the story in it. So basically in this story, there's a beautiful princess. Her name is Elizabeth, which I also loved because it seems like more of not a normal name, but for, you know, these princesses with very beautiful, long, royal names, Elizabeth reminds me more of just like a personal name. So she was going to marry this handsome prince named Ronald, but a dragon comes along, burns everything down, burns off her clothing, and then carries Ronald off. So she decides she's going to go and rescue Ronald, even without clothing on. So she puts on a paper bag and off she goes, and she goes through this process of trying to trick the dragon. She realizes that if he has to fly around a whole bunch, she can wear him out, and then eventually he will fall asleep and she will be able to save Ronald. So she does that, the dragon falls asleep, she gets to Ronald, she's there to rescue him, and he turns to her and basically says that she looks terrible and that she's a hot mess and that she should clean herself up. And she's just like, you know what? No, thank you. And so the very last part of the story essentially says, Ronald, said Elizabeth, your clothes are really pretty and your hair is all neat. You look like a real prince, but you are a bum. They didn't get married after all. And I think maybe that had an effect on me. So reading a little bit of a twist on the sort of typical story where the princess has to be rescued, and turns out in the end, she doesn't even need to be with that particular partner. So I like that story from a little bit of Canadian contribution to the world of fairy tales. And I've mentioned, I think, a little bit already that fairy tales, thankfully, are changing. So how we look at stories about families and passing down different messages, I think, has really become positive in a lot of Disney's later movies, most recently. So you might not have seen some of these yet because they just came out last year, but I actually just finished writing a chapter in a textbook of Disney studies, and I looked at how animated female Disney characters are becoming more positive role models. I talk about how there are new cultures to the Disney realm, so the sort of Disney world of stories, including Colombian culture in the film Encanto. So you can see the top GIF or GIF, there's a battle there, there with Mirabel and her mom. And what I love about this little image is that it has the Spanish. And I think it's really important to mention that Encanto is actually the first Disney movie to include a full song in Spanish in the film. And that to me is a huge step forward. We've seen little bits and pieces of other cultures, like as was mentioned with Mulan and a little bit with Aladdin, but certainly this film is a very positive portrayal of their family relationship and their cultural traditions. I picked one with Mirabel here holding up an arepa, which is a delicious treat that I went on quite a journey to find. And I think that that's really important too, because these movies bring other cultures to children's lives. And for me, I am always very excited when I get to try new things. And with not being able to travel a lot in the pandemic, I was on sort of a journey to try new things still. And so this led me to some Colombian restaurants in my neighborhood, which I would not have done because I wouldn't have even known about an arepa prior to this movie. So I think that those things are really important in bringing more cultures into popular culture. And the other one that just came out is Disney's Pixar film Turning Red, which is about a Chinese-Canadian young woman who is learning how to grow up in a city, which actually is Toronto. So those are really nice portrayals. They might not be perfect of the Colombian and Chinese culture, but they're certainly getting closer to more positive representation. The other thing that I think is really important about fairy tales now is that they're dealing a lot more with emotions and how to manage them. I think that's great, not just for children, but for adults. I think we often forget that adults don't really, like, we don't really spend any time with kids or teenagers really explicitly talking about how emotions can really overwhelm us and lead us to make bad choices sometimes. So I think that these two films are beautiful examples of how Disney is changing. And of course, many other animated films are coming out as well. I don't know if you saw it, but there was one called Over the Moon, which was another, I believe, Chinese fairy tale that was brought to life. And so lots of other studios are also working to bring more positive representations of female characters in their films. So that's my sort of overview for the moment. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you enjoy.
Thank you so much. If you guys have questions for Dr. Morton, feel free and go ahead, ask your questions.
Yes, I have one question, and I noticed that Disney is focused on was for in my childhood, the Disney focused on the fairy tale is about a princess, a beauty, but totally different nowadays. Yeah, that is the big change, I think.
I think it's such a huge change, and I think really the first time we saw that was maybe with Frozen in 2013, where, if you haven't seen it, sorry, spoiler, but at the very end of that film, it's not a true love between a male and a female character, but rather the fact that they're sisters, that their love for each other as sisters is the true love. And I think that that was such an important shift, because of course we know that women have more going on in life than just the partner. So I think it was a beautiful transition to show different kinds of love. And absolutely, as you mentioned, more recent films like with Encanto and Turning Red, they both focus more on family issues and challenges than the true love and finding a partner. So I think it's a beautiful shift. Thank you. Marty?
You know that there is a problem. We grow up on that system. Yeah. And yeah. Now, you know, that we grow up on that system, and there are lots of things that in my hand on that system. And now, you know, that maybe it's a big change, it's a revolution, but I think that it's not for me. But, you know, that it's, yeah, but it's good for the future, for the new generation. It's good. It's a good trail. It's a good trail, but always in my country, in my for my generation, they say that burned generation. Do you know?
So yes. The fiery generation.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
But it's good for the new generation, but it's not for us now.
Yeah, and I was gonna say, I think part of it too is also looking at how the older generations, i.e. myself as well, are learning about that. And Turning Red is really nice because it also shows the mom learning about her daughter as well. And I think that's something maybe we never really thought about, or at least I certainly don't remember seeing, you know, as a child, looking at those are the kinds of conflicts you have the most as a kid, right? with your parents or your guardians, whoever is in charge of you. So those are the arguably the relationships that you need to learn to navigate the soonest. So finding a partner, great, for sure. It's still something that people like to do. We also have, you know, more stories of different relationships to look at. That's maybe the way to sort of combine what we're used to with some of the newer ideas.
Thank you.
Great point.
I just recently watched Encanto, and I have to say that I absolutely loved it. The music and everything. I'll have to see if I can find that the food you mentioned. It seems so much more real, right? So different from all the other classic fairy tales. I highly recommend watching it. It's a really great one.
I actually don't have a question, but I was thinking, like women actually are different from men in many ways. So the feminism is looking for the equality, I mean, for both men and women, we're fighting for the same right. It's not kind of everything we should be exactly same as them. Like if we're physically weak than them, so there are certain jobs probably women are not suitable to do it. We're not fighting for something, in every situation, we should be treated equally, but not looking for things, you know, like 50% of women should be working in certain circumstances. As I'm thinking probably it's not that way. Also, I was thinking like a fairy stories, they especially for those already passed to many generations, still many good traits for us to learn from. It's not always, I just want to say the traditional stories are not always need to change, but if they change to the right direction, they will be welcomed in anyways. But we're not looking for changes or for all things for all, also all the time, but we're looking for positive changes.
Excellent point. And yes, I made a note in the chat just so you could see the spelling difference. I mentioned equality, but truly what I'm looking for is equity. So not sameness exactly, because we are definitely not the same. we can all agree. Women have very different approaches to a lot of things. And so it's more about highlighting what we need in order to have access to the same things rather than, you're right, not being the same. That's exactly right.
If there's no more questions, I would just like to go ahead and ask Dr. Morton. You mentioned that your students, high school students, watch movies, and you talk about that. And I was wondering if very quickly you could share with us. I'm curious as to what fairy tales or movies do young people watch these days?
Okay, well, I'm currently teaching grade 12 right now, a film and literature course. And so we just did a children's film and literature unit, and we talked about all the fairy tales that they've watched growing up and a lot of Disney. And part of what I like to have them do is rewatch something that they love to pick it apart. Now it's a win and a loss in the sense that the kids always do an incredible job looking at things in a completely different way, but then they often can't appreciate the joy they felt as a child watching it over and over again. So I don't know off the top of my head. I can't remember specifically what they had watched when they were younger, but many of them did their presentations on things that I had never even thought of as sort of young people. It wasn't specifically related to fairy tales. It was more children's movies for that particular activity and books. And they just chose really neat things. And so I think the other thing about kids today is that they have access to so much more media. We were sort of in the VHS rewind, replay, and they still do that for sure with Disney Plus and other streaming services, but they also have access to things like YouTube, where there are all sorts of different things there. So a lot of the things that they shared were just really new to me. So it was neat to see the different variety of things that keep coming up as I sort of age out of what is currently popular for the kids. Yeah.
Thank you so much. It's great to have them rewatch pieces of classic fairy tales and get that into the classroom as a teaching tool. Dr. Morton, thank you so much for today's presentation. Beautifully illustrated, entertaining, and over 500 versions of Cinderella. That's impressive. I also appreciate how you brought into discussion how emotions can be looked at through fairy tales. And also I wanted to thank all the participants for their great comments. Like, I could just sit here and listen to you guys. Thank you so much. Now, if that's okay, we are going to move on and do a little bit of the teaching material that we have created for today's topic. So fairy tales and feminism. And Dr. Morton talked about Cinderella. Well, I have prepared a classic fairy tale. Is just the movie trailer, Snow White, and then we'll have a look at the movie trailer from a more classic, a more new one, that's Moana, okay? So what I want you to look at, just think of similarities and differences between these two fairy tales, okay? I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen, and we will watch the two movie trailers. So focus on similarities and differences, okay?
Magic mirror on the wall. Who is the fairest one of all?
Island has been home to our family. But beyond our reef, a great danger is coming. Legend tells of a hero who will journey to find the demigod Maui. And together, they will save us all.
Lue, 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 lue.
Maui, shapeshifter, demigod of the wind and sea, I am
hero of men.
What?
It's actually Maui, shapeshifter, demigod of the wind and sea, hero of men. I interrupted from the top. Hero of men. Go. I'm not going on a mission with some little girl.
This is my canoe, and you will journey to different.
Did not see that coming.
The ocean is a friend of mine.
First, we've got to go through a whole ocean of bad. Kakamora.
Kaka what? They're kind of cute.
Whoa. your back. It's Maui time.
Really? Blow dart in my butt cheek.
We're going to the realm of monsters?
Don't worry, it's a lot farther down than it looks.
All right, so I'm going to put you in breakout rooms and give you, let's say, around 2 minutes to just share your take on similarities and differences between the two movie trailers. You do not need to go into details, okay? All right, thank you, everyone. So if you look at the screen, I just typed some of the similarities and differences that I heard you talk about. I really liked Miranda's discussion. She gave a really full account of differences. Miranda, do you mind reading the last sentence?
The last sentence?
Yes.
Moana is about indigenous people, not about marriage. How to be yourself. You need to be brave. A very different way to look girls, women.
Very good. I think you actually nailed it. And then I think it was Marjam who talked about similarities. Both fairy tales have good characters. They help weak people. Let's move on and have a look at a little bit of vocabulary. You also have the documents. I'm going to go ahead and share my document again. So if you look at the screen here, we have Snow White and Moana. And there's a little bit of vocab for us to have a look at. Jealous, wicked, murder, stepdaughter, disguised, witch, and poisoned. These are to be matched with the descriptions 1 to 7. And then Moana, adventurous, mission, journey, encounter, quest, ancestor, and identity to be matched with the 7 definitions. Now, these words are also in the brief summaries that I shared with you, okay? So again, feel free to look at the main screen. I'm gonna copy paste these words in the chat, and I'm going to put you back in breakout rooms to have a look at the vocabulary, all right? All right, so welcome back, everyone. Before I show you the answer key to this vocabulary activity, I would like for you to tell me the answers, okay? So feel free to unmute yourself and share the answers with me. How about the first one? Kill or take someone's life?
Murder.
Murder.
Jonah, so cheerful, thank you. Let's move on. Go ahead and read and give me the answers. I want you guys to speak more than me. Thank you, Joanna. Someone else, second.
Poisoned.
Very good. Very good. Next, number three.
Stepdaughter.
Stepdaughter. Beautiful. Number four.
Witch.
Witch. Yes. Thank you. Number five.
Jealous.
Jealous.
Jealous. We all know that one, don't we? Number six.
Disguise.
Can you say again, please?
Disguise.
Yes, disguise. Disguise, not disgusting. Yeah.
Disguise. No, disguise is adjective.
Disguise is a verb. You disguise. You put on a makeup, wear something else to look different. Whereas disgusting is an adjective. Yuck. You don't like whether it's food or what someone is doing or saying. Yeah, disgusting. It's an adjective. This one is a verb. Disguise. Very good. How about the last one here?
Wicked.
Wicked. Not weak, yeah? Not weak. Wicked. Wicked.
Bad. Wicked.
Very good. Awesome. Wicked. Let's have a look at the second set of vocab from Moana.
Long search for something such truth or knowledge. It's just quest.
Quest, very good. So that's a different word, maybe a more difficult one, quest, but it's for a long search. Beautiful. How about the second one?
A member of
ancestor. A good word to know. Yeah, very good. How about the third one?
Afraid of going to place and doing dangerous
adventurous.
Adventurous.
Adventurous. Yes, beautiful. Number four.
Journey.
We all know that one. Yeah, journey. Number five.
Experience problem of people who are trying to do something. Encounter.
Good. How about number six?
Some of the quality. Identity.
And last one?
Something you want because you feel is
mission.
Mission.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Now here is the answer key. If you want to take a screenshot or just have a second look and make sure you got all your answers right. All right. So let's move on. I would like to go on and talk a little bit about the two fairy tales. And again, don't worry about the movie trailers. We also have the written summaries. And the questions that I would like for you to have a look at are these. Why was the queen jealous of Snow White? How did the queen try to kill Snow White? Why did Moana sail out on a mission? What did Moana discover on her journey on the ocean? Which fairy tale is better if you like love stories and why? There's no right and wrong answers here. Which fairy tale is better if you like adventures and why? Which fairy tale is better if we want to teach girls to be independent and why? And the last one here, which heroine do you like more, Snow White or Moana? Again, no right or wrong answers, just your opinions, okay? I'm going to put you in breakout rooms. This time I'm going to give you more minutes. I'm especially interested in the last four questions, okay? So last part of today's workshop, let's have a look at either part one or part two. So what I would like for you to do in your breakout rooms, you will either retell a classic fairy tale like Snow White so that the female character has more equal right with the male character. So that, for instance, Snow White becomes more independent. Or option two, you can discuss a fairy tale from your own culture, but make sure it is through a feminist lens. In other words, make sure that a heroine has equal rights, has equal rights with the male character. All right, thank you. Thank you all so much. It was lovely to listen to you talk, and I really think that you should have run this workshop, you the students and not me. I really like to listen to Joanna, her story of Mulan, taught us that actually the female character can be stronger. So roles were reversed. Two thumbs up for your retelling of the story. That was really good. Marjam had her own story, and I really like that. Miranda also shared one story from her culture. And one common thread was this forever, happily ever, right? Whether that's together with a partner or on your own. And I really like that. And I would like that to be, at the end of our workshop on fairy tales, which again ties back into Dr. Morton's PhD dissertation, Emotionally Ever After. That was it today for fairy tales and feminism. Thank you so much. Hope to see you next week. Different guest speaker, different topic. I appreciate Dr. Morton telling us about fairy tales, about her own experiences, the book she read as a child, and we all learned a lot from her. Thank you all so much. Have a great weekend and hope to see you next Thursday. Bye now.
Thank you.